This episode of Fine Scale Modeler's new product rundown features Airfix's 148th scale Mustang, Tamiya's SS100, Academy's B47, Kajika's Hiai, and a special edition of Squadron's Hanabu 2.
This episode of New Product Rundown brought to you by Hobby Zone USA, the source for all your workbench storage needs. Welcome to New Product Rundown, Fine Scale Modeler's twice monthly show where we lay bare the plastic inside the latest kits. I'm Aaron Skinner.
And I'm Elizabeth Nash. We have some terrific kits to look at this time, including Airfix's 148th scale P51D.
Now, you'd have to have been in a bunker for the last 25 years not to know just how many 148th scale Mustang kits there are out there.
So what makes Airfix's kit worthy of your attention and dollars? Let's take a look.
The fuselage halves show the crisp, slightly heavy recessed panel lines seen on recent Airfix kits.
Molded circles represent Zeus fasteners around the cowl, petite recessed rivets outline some panels, and the fairing for the wing root is slightly raised as it should be.
The wings have panel lines and rivets molded on. Some modelers will want to fill many of these to represent the factory putty used on Mustang wings.
The one-piece lower wing includes deeply recessed but not open shell ejection ports.
All of the control surfaces are separate, including the rudder, elevators, and ailerons.
Optional parts allow the flaps to be posed up or drooped, as often seen in photos of Mustangs on the ground.
Separate airframe parts include the upper cowl, lower inner wing leading edges with part of the nose and the front of the landing gear bay, two different vertical tails with optional fillets, an early version fitted to the Block 10 and 15 aircraft, it has a slight curve, and one with a straight profile fitted to later aircraft.
The opening for the ventral radiator scoop is a single piece with thin leading edges. The rest of the radiator has sides, bottom, faces, and posable exit flap.
The 50 caliber gun muzzles come as two inserts for the wing leading edges.
The kit uses flush breather plates, but louvered options are included on the tree.
Both marking options use shrouded exhausts, but the kit provides unshrouded also.
And there are two styles of tires in the box. They are keyed to fit the well-molded landing gear legs, so the flat face meets the ground.
Airfix nails the shape of the main gear bay, showing the rear wall to be the main spar. There's plenty of detail here.
The gear doors have detail on the inside faces. The cuff-bladed propeller gets sandwiched into a two-part spinner that includes interior details. There's even a dome shell that won't be seen on the assembled prop.
The cockpit fits onto an interior section that includes the floor, front bulkhead, turtle deck, roof of the radiator intake, and the tail wheel well.
It includes a three-part seat with molded seat belts and a separate armored backplate.
The turtle deck's radio equipment are separate, and the instrument panel with molded dials and instruments fits onto a part with attached pedals.
Sidewall inserts show molded details, and they receive more controls, hoses, and decal placards.
The sides of the tail well incorporate the doors. They can be cut off and replaced with a separate part for the closed doors.
Optional wing racks can be fitted with 75-gallon metal drop tanks, 108-gallon paper drop tanks, triple bazooka rocket launchers, and bombs unused in this kit.
Clear parts provide three canopies, although only one is called out in the instructions. Optional windshields allow for rearview mirrors to be installed, if desired. Also on the clear sprue are a landing light, ID lights, and gun sight.
Cartograph decals supply markings for two U.S. Mustangs. Little Indian from the 2nd Air Commando Group in Kalikunda, India in 1945, and Jersey Jerk of the 361st Fighter Squadron in England in 1945.
So out of the box, Airfix's Mustang looks like it should build into a nice replica. But if you want more detail, check out all the sets Edward already has available.
If you want to bump up the cockpit a little, there's an interior pre-colored photo etch set with instrument panel, switches, throttle quadrant, and turtle deck details.
Or you can take the cockpit up several steps with the brassen replacement for the tub, seat, panel, and more.
Another PE set refines exterior details, including radiator screens, tail wheel well, radiator exit, bomb fins, and oleo scissors.
From Brassen, there are drop-in replacement ailerons, elevators, and rudder,
shrouded exhausts, and unshrouded exhausts.
Also available are a Brassen replacement Hamilton standard propeller and spinner, diamond pattern wheels with sidewall labeling, as well as a new tailwheel strut and wheel, gun sight, and rearview mirrors.
And to improve the underwing stores, Brassen has 75-gallon drop tanks with PE plumbing and decal stencils, 108-gallon paper tanks also with PE details and plumbing as well as decals, and the bazooka launcher with resin racks, PE straps, and optional loaded and unloaded rear ends.
That's a ton of extra detail.
So if you want to build Airfix's Mustang straight out of the box, you'll be rewarded with a good-looking kit.
Or you can pick and choose what Edward has to offer. There's probably more sets on the way.
Next, we have Tamiya's 148 scale SS100 heavy tractor.
Now, Tacum's produced this same vehicle in 135th scale, both by itself and with a V2 Miller wagon launch pad.
But this model would fit perfectly with a 148th scale aircraft, like the HE219 shown on the box.
Tamiya keeps things pretty simple with a one-piece chassis, including the lower part of the engine, transmission, drive shaft, and part of the rear differential. Fenders and running boards fit to the chassis, along with the leaf springs and front and rear axles.
The wheels are molded in plastic and incorporate the tires. The
towing unit comprises several parts with separate tools.
The main body is a single part featuring recessed door outlines and molded engine louvers. The windshield and back panel are separate, as is the radiator, toolboxes, and fuel tank.
The cab's interior includes two bench seats, steering wheel, and controls.
A tow bar slips into the towing hitch.
Clear parts provide the truck's windshield, as well as side and rear windows.
And there's a driver figure for the cab.
Decals provide serial number plates for two Luftwaffe SS-100s, along with one each from the German Army and Navy.
This looks like it'll be a quick build that will add some drama to an aircraft display.
Or look good just by itself.
While we're in the mood for quick looks, we have Academy's 1144 scale B-47.
This is actually a reissue of Hobbycraft Canada's nice Stratajet from 1998.
Unfortunately, Boeing's pretty strategic bomber hasn't had a lot of love from plastic kit manufacturers, but this kit stands out from the pack.
Given the scale, the kit is relatively simple, but the fuselage halves show fine recessed panel lines.
They sandwich small, slightly detailed tandem gear bays, and a cockpit with seats, control yokes, and a side console.
The landing gear looks pretty good for the size, with detailed wheels and separate oleo scissors. The landing gear doors have detail inside.
The wing comes as full-span upper and lower halves with characteristic anhedral molded in. All of the control surfaces are molded in place.
The engines, including the outboard single pod and the inner double pods, feature one-piece intakes and exhausts.
One of the kit's highlights is the options, including three different noses, underwing tanks, reconnaissance pods and different wingtips for RB-47s, JATO inserts for early models, and early and late tail turrets.
The kit's only clear part is the long canopy.
The other highlight is the extensive marking options provided. 11 U.S. Air Force Stratojets are shown, including two B-47Bs at MacDill Air Force Base, three Es, four Bs, upgraded to E standard, and two RB-47Hs. The sheet includes the anti-glare panel and canopy framing.
This is not a huge model, but it produces a good-looking replica of this important bomber.
Next, we head to sea with Kajika's 1700 scale Japanese battlecruiser, Hiei.
Designed by a British ship engineer and commissioned in 1914, this Kongo-class battlecruiser served the Japanese Navy in World War I and World War II.
The ship was sunk by Allied warplanes at Guadalcanal in November 1942.
This waterline model represents the ship in 1915.
The single-piece hull has finely molded hull plates and deeply recessed portholes.
A base plate covers the waterline void, and there's a space in it to fit a metal bar as ballast.
The bi-level deck comes in two parts with molded planks, anchor chains, bollards, and skylights.
The superstructures are molded as single parts with hatches and portholes.
The main gun turrets have upper and lower halves that trap the barrels. Typical of early battleships, smaller guns line the casemates around the hull.
Detailed ship's boats and steam launches fill the decks. They are detailed inside and out with planks and benches.
Petite multi-part masts support decks and crow's nests with molded structural details. Small parts, such as searchlights, pipes, and guns, are sharply molded.
As are the torpedo net supports, davits, ladders, and controls. The smokestacks are slide molded single pieces with separate caps.
Out of the box, this kit will produce a decent looking model, really only lacking PE railings.
But Kajika has that covered with several aftermarket detail sets that let you build the model pretty much any way you want to.
There's a photo etch set with railings, ladders, captain's walk, funnel caps, boat and deck supports, and crane rigging.
Then there's a self-adhesive wooden deck to quickly improve the appearance of the horizontal surfaces.
If you prefer to paint the decks, the company offers a set of pre-cut masks. I assume they can't be used with the wooden deck, but they may work with care.
There are turn metal barrels for both the 14-inch main guns and the 6-inch secondary armament.
There's also generic chain to replace the molded details, and fine rigging thread made by Yushi.
And finally, to properly display your masterpiece, there's a display base with notations and a Perspex nameplate.
A great looking plastic kit with plenty of extras if you want.
Yeah, nice effort from a new manufacturer, at least us. Now enjoy this cultural interlude. Alone but never dreary, he cuts the plastic daily, yearly, from carton kits and varied bits, less or more.
While he chips and fills and splatters, a bookcase filled with modeling matters, things that matter leaning near his door.
His head and eyes to wander, his mind is left to ponder, the craven of the ravens near his door.
5 years of precious time spent on a Boeing 29, but 29s with him, they do not highly score.
To 8 therefore stacks and Mitchells, his heart will gladly switch till his house is overflowing, overflowing with room no more.
But on the bookcase lying, boxes glistening, winking, sighing, the ravens seeming crying, just one more. For it's dioramas truly, men, machines, and parts unruly, that keep him turning, turning, coming back for more.
A kit's surely no presentation, if in splendid isolation, if it sits in isolation on the floor. But as he is digressing, the raven mocking, distressing, sit there silently confessing evermore.
A kit needs some form of drama, some type of hype or turning karma, some mild repose or gentle telling of some lore.
Props all bent and twisted, bits missing, shot or shifted, and if cockpit deep in water, better more.
And as the setting resin glistens, and the offspring kindly listen, the ravens gently hissen, evermore.
It's active planes that thrill him. Factory fresh will nearly kill him. Factory fresh with no exhaust stains to the fore.
It must be duly weathered, or to heck and I'll be beggared. I'll be beggared if it moves from out my door.
And as his wash is drying, his masterpiece he's eyeing, the raven softly sighing, evermore.
And as they lie there mocking, lack of space and workbench shocking, for parts lost, in vain he hunts upon the floor.
He'd rather raise the trusses, can't understand the fusses, in getting footing plans passed through the council door.
How much longer, how much more, to the heavens he implores. Finally, quoth the raven, evermore.
Finally, let's see what's new in the premium edition of Squadron's 172nd Scale Hanabu 2.
We looked at the basic kit several episodes back, and as you can tell, it builds into an impressive model.
It's not for everyone's taste, but I've seen many finished in very creative camouflage schemes.
But none have done what this kit does. Turns the vehicle into a civilian transport, or as they refer to it, as travel expedition version.
The basic kit is here, with hull, rotating gun turrets, detailed flight deck, and posable ramp.
Newer resin parts for an observation deck to replace the main guns. You'll have to perform some surgery to fit the deck. Details dress up the front plate, and there's an optional vacuum-formed clear bubble for the top.
Resin also adds a bunker to the upper surface, a radome to the hull, and replaces the kit's plastic wheels.
Underneath, resin inserts take the place of the gun turrets. The centers can be filled with resin lasers covered by large domes, or clear bubbles for lights also covered by the larger domes.
Decals provide markings for a single ship with serial numbers, eagles with the earth, and slogans.
The painting diagram shows it painted in bare aluminum with a red stripe and other accents.
I had a blast building the military version of this kit, and the civilian option gives you many more opportunities for creative displays. And if you really want to wear your Hanabu with pride, Squadron offers this attractive t-shirt.
Look for reviews of the Mustang and Hiai in upcoming issues of Fine Scale Modeler magazine or on our website.
And you can find more new products in the December issue on sale now.
Thanks for visiting finescale.com. I'm Elizabeth Nash.
And I'm Aaron Skinner. We'll see you next time.
Zedix. Now he's got something.
That's a ton of extra detail. It's Turkey Nash.
Welcome. Just in time.
Happy Thanksgiving, people.